Hi everyone, this is Dr. Bitla Venu. In continuation to my previous session, Fundamentals of SIM and Fundamentals of FMS, Flexible Manufacturing System, and Computer Integrated Manufacturing System, we have discussed in our last session. In today's session, we will move ahead to discuss what are AGVs, what exactly, how AGV is going to work, and what are the components required for AGVs. AGV stands for Automated Guided Vehicles, which are used in industries to improve the efficiency of the plant and as well as to reduce the cost of the product. Basically, these are the transporting devices used to transport raw materials between different machines. And what are different types of AGVs available, and we will discuss those in this session. Then we move forward to see what are automated storage and retrieval systems. We will see in depth, and we will also look into the terminology used in the automated storage and retrieval systems. Then we will move forward to see the coordinate measuring machine, CMM machine, which is used to measure the coordinates of the components to check the final accuracy of the component manufactured in an industry. Then we move forward to see the classification of the robots, how the classifications are classified with respect to different parameters. We will discuss one by one in this session. So let me move forward to see what is actually automated guided vehicle, AGV. As I said just now, AGVs are the vehicles which are used to transport the goods between the machines. It is equipped with the automatic guidance system. So we have some transporting systems which are guided in a specified path, following the pre-described path. That means it is already defined, and the path is controlled by a controller which is located somewhere else. There are different types of vehicles. Automated, by the name, we can say that automated guided vehicles means those are automated vehicles and controlled by a control unit which is located somewhere else. So the path of these vehicles are controlled by another unit, predetermined path. So this is so that we are calling this as automated guided vehicles, as you can see. So all these vehicles are pro-programmed. So unlike traditional robots, AGVs are not manipulators. So we will discuss in detail what are the robots in our coming session. But these are not manipulator. Manipulator is just like, as of now, you think that manipulator is a device which consists number of links to perform some task. It is the part of the robot, as of now you think in that way. Okay, this is not just like a manipulator of the robot. Manipulator is going to perform some work which consists different links, which is the part of the robot. But whereas this is not like the part of the robot, it is a vehicle which is used to transport the goods between the machines in a predetermined path, or programmed path. So in that way, are guided. Even the vehicles are guided. And moreover, these vehicles are driverless vehicles. All the automated guided vehicles are driverless vehicles, in which the vehicles doesn't have drivers. So those are going to run with the help of the programmer. Programmer, which is fed in a controller device, which is going to control the movement of the vehicles. So once again, I emphasize you that these automated guided vehicles doesn't have drivers, which are controlled by the program of the controller, which fed in the controller in a predetermined path. In automated factories and facilities, AGVs move pallets and containers. AGVs are going to move pallets and containers. Basically, pallet is a device which is on which the raw material or finished goods are kept. in turn, that pallet is placed on the vehicles, and that pallet will be moved. So instead of placing the finished goods or raw material directly on the vehicle, we have some platform. So as of now, you think that pallet is a platform used to locate or place the material over it, and that pallet will be moved by the vehicles to transport the goods in between the vehicles. This is what the pallet. So they may be used to deliver and pick up the mail, pick up to the mail, and these vehicles are used to deliver and pick up. These vehicles are going to pick up the goods and as well as the deliver the goods. They are even used to transport the patrons around in airports. That means these are also used to transport the patrons around in airports. The main benefit of AGV is that it reduces the labor cost, and it also reduces the accidents. If there is any movement, irregular movement or zigzag movement, which is defined, which is not defined, if the path of the vehicle is not defined properly, accidents may occur. So during the material handling, accidents may occur. So because of this, when we use AGVs, automated guided vehicles, there should not be any accidents. So we can avoid accidents when we use automated guided vehicles. That's what I would like to say. Material handling has always been dangerous if we move the material manually because of irregular path, because of not paying attention, or because of maybe due to the accidents, due to the obstacles, or because of improper sensing. So these automated guided vehicles are going to move in a predetermined path by the controller mechanism with a program. Already we have a program on which path this vehicle have to move, at what time this vehicle needs to pick up the goods, at what time this vehicle needs to deliver the goods at the different location. All this will be taken care by the program, but not the human being. Because of that, the accuracy and the time saving and floor space also reduces. We can optimize everything with respect to the time of transportation, with respect to the floor space, with respect to the accidents. Everything we can optimize using the automated guided vehicles. Then let us see a small figure here. We have a warehouse here from where we are going to pick up the raw material or the finished goods, where all the finished goods will be kept at this location. Then you can see one AGV here, automated guided vehicles, and this vehicle is going to move on the predetermined path, and there is one controller here, and we have the communication network here. This AGV will be controlled by using a controller which is located at somewhere else. So that means we must also require the network to control this driverless vehicle. In turn, we can call it as automated guided vehicles. We must require the networks, we must require the controller unit, we must require the computer, we must require the, these are the driverless, these needs to move with the battery, it also requires the battery. So let us see all the components required in AGVs in the coming slides. Then let me move further to see what are the components of the AGVs. Components of the AGV's system is that it requires the vehicle. AGV system must require a vehicle to transport the goods from one location to another location. And it also requires the traction to provide the movement. So vehicle requires some tracks to move one location to another location or to move vehicle in a predetermined path. Okay. Then traction batteries to provide power. It also requires the traction batteries to move from one location to another location. It is obvious we need to rotate. We require a motor, and with that motor, vehicle needs to move. Battery is only the source, power source to move the vehicle from one location to another location. Then it also requires industrial PC or a control, an onboard controller. We must require controller where all the programs will be fed related to the movement of the vehicles. Then it also requires the payload interface. This may be a fork, platform, and a conveyor, lift, deck interface. We also require an interface to lift the loads and as well as to convey the goods from one location to another location. Then let us see what are other components required in the next slide. Let us see. So we also require, along with the vehicles, we also require the safety systems. That means SUV must include the appropriate safety systems which ensures the hazards should not occur. But to avoid the hazards, we must require, the safety system must be incorporated in the plant. I mean, this must be the part of the AGV system. While operating AGV system also requires the appropriate safety system. Okay. Then, as I said just now, this AGV system also requires the battery charging system. So, as and when the vehicles are idle and on board, the vehicles needs to charge. And there must be provision to charge all these batteries of the vehicles 24/7. This facility must be provided in the, this must be the part of the AGV. Then it must also require the communication. The main controller communicates the peripheral devices via Ethernet. We have, as I said, we have a main computer or a controller, and that will be connected to the Ethernet or with the wire. But whereas the peripheral devices may communicate each other during the communication protocol, such as OPC, CAN, and Modbus. So by buses are parallelly, you can connect all those devices which are the used to communicate between the systems. Okay, or with the help of Wi-Fi or input-output devices, we can use to communicate the devices, to communicate each other. Then it also requires the navigation system. The vehicles require a navigation system that provides the ability to vehicle to identify its position. And navigation system means every instant the vehicle coordinates or the vehicle speed and vehicle position must be tracked. So that this AGV system must have this navigation system to track the vehicle position also. Then it also requires the traffic management system, and central controller provides the traffic management system that organizes the controls and controls the movement of the AGVs around the area of the operation. Of course, we have a controller. That controller will take care of the traffic management system according to the programs that we fed in that controller. Then job control system, the central control system not only organizes the movement of the AGVs around the facility, but also collect the job initiation. So it also collects the job initiation data also. Then let me move further to see the external components also require, some of the external components are also required in this case. Such as the buffer conveyors and which are aid the overall pass. Buffer conveyors also required, and the interfaces receive and generate the appropriate commands for the AGV's control system. There are some external devices which are integrated, or which may be the part of the networking system, which may be the part of the batteries, or which may be the part of the control system. There are some external devices which are used at that location. So those are called the external devices. Then let me move further to see what are the different types of AGVs. There are three basic types of AGVs. So those are driverless trains. Then we have the pallet trucks, unit load carriers. So driverless trains, basically AGV means driverless, and pallet trucks, unit load carriers. So these are all the three types of AGVs, but basically AGV means driverless. Blindly you can say that AGV is a driverless. Now you see what is driverless train. It consists a towing vehicle that pulls one or more trains to form a train. That means a vehicle consists number of containers attached to together like a train. Okay, so this type is applicable for moving heavy payloads over a large distance. Basically, this type of driverless trains are used to transport the goods or the finished or raw material between the different missions, where the distance between them is more. It consists of nearly 5 to 10 trailers, 5 to 10 boxes like the containers or the boxes like trains. Then the other one is the pallet trucks. So pallet trucks are used to load and unload along predetermined routes. So pallet trucks are used to load and unloading along the predetermined routes. So you can see pallet is located on the truck, and during the idle time the pallets are loaded with the material, and the truck will collect that pallet. Pallet is nothing but a platform where all the goods will be loaded, and the vehicle collects that pallet, and that pallet will be moved to the desired location. It is a platform as of now. So think that pallet is a platform where all the material will be placed. The capacity of an AGV pallet truck ranges to several thousand kilograms, and some are capable of handling two pallets. Of course, the pallet, some vehicles can handle one pallet, and some other vehicles can handle multiple pallets also to carry more number of goods. Then we have unit load carrier. These are used to move unit loads from one station to another station. This unit loads means a single heavy weight loads, which can carry only a single load. It is used for automatic loading and unloading of pallets using the rollers. Using the rollers, pallets will be loaded on the truck or the vehicle. Load capacity ranges up to 250 kgs or less, and these vehicles are designed to move small loads. Basically, these unit load carriers are not used for heavy loads. Please make a correction. These are used to carry small weight loads at about 250 kgs or less, and these vehicles are designed to move small loads. These are the driverless pallet trucks and unit load carriers are that we will see in the next figure. Now you can see this is a driverless truck which is used to carry the containers and like a train boxes, connected to each other, and all those trailer carts are connected to one driver driving station. Okay, so this is going to just like an engine, this is going to act as an engine in train, which is going to pull all the trailer carts in which all the goods will be located. Okay. So this is a driverless. As you can see, this is operated using a battery, used to pull the different trailers. It is a driverless in the predetermined path, which is controlled by the controller of the AGV system, where the programs are going to be fed. Then as we discussed just now, pallet trucks. As you can see, pallet here, pallet is just a platform where all the goods will be placed before transporting the goods, which will be placed on this. It is a dais or a platform where the goods will be placed, and the vehicle will pull this pallet, and vehicle will carry this pallet instead of carrying the objects directly, instead of placing the objects directly on the truck. So the objects will be placed on the pallet, and the vehicle is going to carry this pallet in turn. And this is the pallet trucks. Then we have the unit load trucks. As you can see, even you can see pallet is already placed on the carrier or the truck, and on which we are going to place the goods. So, for which we want to move from one location to another location. In all these three cases, we don't have any, all these three are not going to operate by a driver. So all these are operated by using the batteries, controlled by a controller unit, where we are going to feed the programs, which the programs are related to the movements of these goods, movements of these vehicles, particularly to move in a specified path. Then let me move further to see what are automated storage and devices. Automated storage and retrieval systems is basically a warehouse system at that location. If it is a very big manufacturing industry, the volume of items and components are so large. So that becomes extremely difficult and time consuming to store the material and to retrieve the material. So if it is a very big industry, number of material, number of items needs to be located at some storage location, and whenever we want, we need to pick up those material. But it is very tedious task to locate the different items at different location, and whenever we want, picking that item and sorting out and finding out is also very difficult, that item. So this automated storage and retrieval system will take care about all the items used in the plant will be located at the specified address. Whenever we want, whenever the plant needs that item, the automated storage and retrieval system will pick up the specified item or the required item which is located at the predetermined address. All this will be taken care by the automated storage and retrieval system. Automatically, this storage system will locate the items at the predetermined location. And whenever we want, this system is going to pick up according to the need from the specified location and from the specified address. This is what the basic meaning of the automated storage and retrieval system. So in short, we can call it as AS and RS. Okay. An automated storage retrieval system can be defined as a storage system under which a defined degree of automation is to be implemented. Of course, automated defined degree of automation to ensure the precision, accuracy, speed in performing storing and retrieval operations. It is defined as a storage system under which a defined degree of automation is implemented to ensure precision, accuracy, and speed in performing storage and retrieval operations. Basically, a system which is going to retrieve, storage and retrieve the goods, and also ensures the accuracy in storing and retrieving. That is actually the storage, automated storage and retrieval system objective, and you can define in that way. The system which ensures the precision and accuracy in performing the storage and retrieval operations is nothing but ASRS. Then when it comes to the objectives of ASRS, increase the storage capacity, because all the items will be stored in an exact way or in a definite order by locating at a specified location. It optimizes the storage capacity. That means maximum we can use the storage capacity. Then increasing the stock rotation. Stock can be rotated easily. Then utilization of the maximum floor space. That means we can also optimize the floor space utilization. That means the utilization of the floor space also increases. Then recovering the space for the manufacturing facilities. That means we can utilize the space for the manufacturing facilities. That means we can recover some space for the manufacturing facility if we optimize the space available in the plant, so that place can be used for manufacturing purpose also by installing the new machines. So that is what the meaning of this fourth point. Then customer service should be improved. Yes, we can. We are able to exactly locate and retrieve the material with the desired accuracy. This also improves the customer service. Then we have control over the inventories. If we use like this, how many raw material, how much amount of material is present in this, if we automate ASRS, if we use ASRS, automatically we can retrieve the status, inventory status. We can also retrieve the goods or the actual goods available in the storage. This is what the advantage of the or the objective of the ASRS. Then customer service improved. Yes, we are already discussed, and inventories can be improved. We can optimize the items to be stored. Then ensure the safety in storage function. We can also ensure the safety. Safely we can store the items at a specified location without any accidents. Sometimes if we preserve the hazardous equipments or the highly volatile liquids, if we don't maintain precautions, so accidents may occur. So that we can reduce, if we use this ASRS, reduce the accidents. So we can ensure the safety in turn, we can call, right? Increasing the labor productivity in storage function. If we use 10 members in storage side, if we use this system, if we implement ASRS, so the labor, we can reduce the number of people engaged to store. That means we can increase the productivity. Then reduce the labor cost in storage operation. We can reduce the leverage and improving security. In all these we can improve. This ASRS consists of one or more storage passages that are serviced by the storage and retrieval system. We have some consists of one or more storage passages side by side, and we have passages, and to that passage side by side storage and retrieval machines are located. Okay, these storage materials are held by storage stocks of ISLs. A passage, ISLs means a passage between two rows are the seats, as you are aware. The storage retrieval machines are used to deliver and retrieve the machines in and out of the inventory or from the inventory. Storage and retrieval machines are the machines which are going to store and as well as pick up the items from the inventory or from the racks, so where all the goods will be kept. So the terminology related to this we will see with this figure. We have a figure here that we can see. This is actually two rows and two racks of rows. So we have some distance between the two rows, that is called the ISLA, and this is exactly the distance, how much we are maintaining between, what will be the distance we are maintaining between the two racks, storage racks. We have one storage rack here, we have another storage racks here, two rows of racks here. The distance between these two is ISLA, or the passage between the two storage rows, racks of rows, otherwise. Then we have a term that is as a storage and retrieval machine or a stacker machine. So at this location, we are going to store and as well as the retrieve by using, this is what the location where the material will be stored and picked up or retrieved. And then we can also use the P&D, pick up and delivery. It is going to pick up and deliver the items here. And this is what the rack length, this is total length, is rack length, then this is the rack height, then this is the rack width. This is one rack, this indicates one rack, and one rack consists the number of rows. Okay, that we can see here. Then we have, this consists the length, this consists the height and width, like this. So the distance between these two racks is called the ISLA. Just you try to recognize. And P&D indicates the pickup and delivery station, and SR machine means storage and retrieval machine. With this we can store and retrieve. Then pickup and delivery. So these two are the very, very important activities in AS and RS system. These are actually the terminology related to the ASRS. Then what are the components required for ASRS? Let us see What are the components required for ASRS? Then, as I said just now, this also requires let me go back again and so as I said just now, these are all the required storage. Then, so these are the components required, as I said just now, this storage rack and storage structure. Okay, then transport devices, AGVs, conveyors we require in the AGV system, pickup and delivery station, stations, then storage and retrieval machines we require, and then to integrate all, we also require one computer control system. These are all the components required for in AS and RS system, AS and RS, automatic storage and retrieval system. Then let me move further to see, this is all we are already discussed. Then let me move further to see what are the advantages of the AS and RS system. This is more efficient and system helps companies cut expenses by minimizing the number of unnecessary parts and products in storage and improving the organization of the contents of the warehouse. Then automation reduces the labor cost by lowering the workforce requirements. The number of people required reduces when we implement ASRS system. Then modeling and managing the logical representation of the physical storage facilities. Then enabling seamless links to order processing and logistics management to pick up ship the product out for the facility. So these are all the pickup delivery will become easy. With this you can see that means seamless integration between the pickup and delivery systems we have. Then track where the products are stored or stocked, so which suppliers they come from, and length of time they are stored. So everything we can come to know if we implement this system. I mean, up to what time the, how much time the item is stored at that location, and what will be the status of that stock, and which supplier they came from, and all these will be, the data will be retrieved very easily using automatic storage and retrieval system. These are all the advantages of the AS and RS system. Then now let us come to the coordinate measuring machine. So coordinate measuring machine provides the, it is a machine used to measure the coordinates of the component accurately within a less time. We have one machine which is used to measure all the dimensions without, I mean, within a short span of time, which combines all the measuring instruments at one location like that. So traditionally, if we want to measure the dimensions of a component, we require the different devices to measure the flatness, to measure the roundness, to measure the angle, to measure the diameter, to measure the length, width, and height. We require different devices. But whereas we have one and only device used to calculate all these at one location, that is called coordinate measuring machine. So all those devices which are used to measure different parameters are combined together to get one machine, that is called the coordinate measuring machine. So in turn, we can call this machine as one machine used to measure all the dimensions at one location. Okay, so coordinate measuring machine can fill a valuable role in precision measuring because a surface plate, height gauge, and indicator precision inspection procedure are combined to provide fast, accurate, and more convenient alternative to conventional methods for measuring complex parts. That means, as I said just now, all the devices are combined together to get or to measure the values of the component. So that is called the coordinate measuring machine. As I said, surface plate, height gauge, and indicator inspection procedure are combined to provide fast, accurate, and more convenient to use the coordinates of the component. are the dimensions of the component otherwise? Are the geometry of the component? To know the geometry with, and also along with the coordinates, we can use this CMM machine. The CMM can also be a fully automated and linked to a CAD system. It can be fully automated and we can integrate that to the CAD system to retrieve the dimensions of the or the geometry of the component once we place that component on the machine table or the CMM machine table. The working principle of this CMM machine we will discuss in the coming slide, but as of now, we have defined what is CMM machine, which is used to measure the geometry of the component within a short span of time. Instead of measuring different, instead of using different devices to measure the different parameters, but we have only one device, one machine to measure the different parameters like angle, length, width, height, surface roughness, value. So this machine can perform, can measure all those parameters at one location. That machine is called CMM machine, coordinate measuring machine. Then the CMM is an electromechanical system. This is the designed to perform the coordinate metrology. Basically, metrology in which we are going to measure the coordinate values. Coordinate metrology is concerned with the measurement of the actual shape and dimensions of an object, where we are going to get the actual shape and dimensions of the object. And comparing these with the desired shape and dimensions, we are measuring the actual values and comparing these values with the theoretical values, so that we come to know what will be the accuracy of the component. This is what in way we can use this CMM machine. CMM evaluates the location, orientation, dimensions, and geometry of the part or object. This is going to evaluate the location and orientation, dimension, and geometry also. So we will get all the values, all the parameters. So this with the help of this CMM machine. This CMM consists of contact probe, just stylus we have, always that is the blunted tool, otherwise always that is kept in contact with the objects, where we want to measure the dimensions from, for which we want to measure the dimensions. So always this contact probe is going to be in contact with the machine, contact with the component for which we want to measure the values or the dimensions or the geometry, all the coordinate values. So this probe or contact probe is going to be, it gives us, senses the values and gives us the values to the system. So these coordinate values like X, Y, Z coordinates of the probe can be accurately, precisely recorded to obtain the dimensional data concerning to the part geometry. So always, as I said, always this machine consists of a probe, and that probe is always in contact with the component for which we want to measure the coordinate values. This probe will give us all the values. So let us see what exactly the figure of this CMM machine that you can see. This is exactly the CNC CMM machine. As you can see, here we have a probe head and probe or a stylus. So this is having the degree of freedom which can move up and down. It is under the action of the spring to keep this probe always in contact with the workpiece, which is located on the work table. Then basically this is a mechanical structure on which you have, we are going to locate the workpiece. Okay. So then this probe is always made to contact under the action of the spring or under the action of any of the mechanism. This probe is always in contact with the workpiece, which gives us the coordinate values or the geometry values or the geometry parameters of the component for which we want to measure the dimensions or the values or the geometry. Then this is also having the computer system. This machine is also integrated to the computer system to read the values at the probe place, at the work location. Then what are, when it comes to the features and this control of graphical display, yes, this is also one feature, and it also gives us hard copy output of the measured data. the geometry data, then storage and retrieval of the measured data. Of course, it gives us this data also. Then it also feature the other feature, determination of dimensional deviation, because we have actual values and the theoretical values. So if we compare the actual values and theoretical values of the component, which tells us the deviations of the values, how much the deviation it took place with respect to the original dimension, that we come to know using this CMM machine, or with respect to all the dimensions, we can get the deviation values also. Then transfer of dimensional data files to the host computer. It is going to transfer the it should be able to transfer the dimensional data files to the host computer. Yes. Then generation of SPC data, then storage of machine calibration data, measurement comparison with test data parameters. Operation of the CMM through the manual or part program control. It can be controlled by the CMM or manual part program. So these are all the features of the CMM machine. Then when it comes to the advantages, reduces the inspection cycle time, because in traditional method, we have number of setups. I mean, if it is a circular shaped object, we need to keep that in a different wise. If it is a rectangular block, it should be kept in a different holding device, and the measurement devices are also different. So every time the devices we need to change, measuring devices we need to select, then holding devices requires, all this will take much time to measure the dimensions, dimensional parameters of a component. So this reduces the inspection cycle time. If we get the accurate values component, the inspection time also reduces. Then the flexibility increases, the general purpose machine that can be used to inspect a variety of part configurations with minimum changeover time. That means within a less time, we can inspect the component. This is what the meaning. Then reduced operator errors. Yes, if we perform the measuring operation manually, so there may be some errors. So those errors can be reduced if we use this machine. Greater inherent accuracy and precision. Accuracy and precision is more than avoidance of multiple setups. As I said just now, based on the geometry of the component, we need to hold the component. We require the different measuring devices according to the parameters, measuring parameters. All these will be eliminated. Then setups will also be eliminated. Different measuring devices will also be eliminated. So in turn, we will measure the geometry of the component within a less time. These are all the advantages of the CMM, computer, coordinate measuring machine. Now we will discuss industrial robots in our next session. Now let us see what we have seen as of now. CMM advantages we have discussed now, then features of CMM machine we have seen. Even we can integrate this CMM machine with a computer or with the CAD machine to get the geometry of the component. So those geometrical values, actual values measured by the CMM machine, can be compared with the theoretical values which lies in the CAD system to get the deviations of the component, the dimensional deviation of the component we can get. Then we have seen the coordinate measuring machine working principle, advantages of ASRS we have seen. Then terminology related to the ASRS also we have seen. What are the terminologies we have seen, and the components we are listed. Then what are the objectives of ASRS also we have seen. Automatic storage and retrieval system, objectives and advantages we have seen. Then what are the different types of AGVs also we have discussed, in which we have discussed driverless, pallet trucks, and unit load carriers. Then these are the three types of the AGVs that were discussed in this slideshow. Then we are also seeing that the components of the AGV system, what exactly we require to establish or to implement AGV system. that we have seen, then what is the basic working principle of the automated guided vehicle system we have seen? So in this, we have seen all these contents. So thank you one and all for this session. In the next session, we will discuss the robots classification. Then we will see the what is degrees of freedom, classification of robots. Then we will move forward to see the different basic components of the robots system. We will see then the manipulator. Then we will see the different end effectors used along with the robot. Then we will also discuss the applications, disadvantages, and what are the special purpose tools used along with the robot. That also we will discuss in our next class. And finally, we will discuss the role of robots in a computer integrated manufacturing systems. We will also discuss in brief in the next session. So thank you for this session. Thank you one and all.